From the University of California, Irvine, this is the UCI Podcast Video Series, featuring interviews with UCI experts on issues related to COVID-19. I'm Brian Bell. Earlier this week, California Governor Gavin Newsom said that one of the steps needed to reopen the state's economy involves launching a robust program of testing and tracking to identify potential coronavirus carriers. A team at UCI has developed and launched a mobile smartphone application that provides COVID-19 contact tracing anonymously, protecting the privacy of those who use it. Joining me today are two of the members of the team responsible for the mobile app, which is called TrackCOVID. Tyler Yasaka is a software engineer and junior specialist in otolaryngology at the UCI School of Medicine, and Dr. Ronald Sahyouni is an incoming neurosurgery resident at UC San Diego and a former biomedical engineer in UCI's joint MD-PhD medical scientist training program. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.
Tyler, let's start with you. Could you tell our viewers what inspired you to launch this project?
Yeah, I stumbled across a paper that talked about, the paper was developing some models, some epidemic simulation models. And basically what the authors concluded was that we're kind of looking at either locking things down, you know, things like social distancing, lots of places being shut down for potentially a long time, maybe until a vaccine is available, which, you know, might be a year or more. Either that or very significant strain on the healthcare system and loss of life. They have one sentence there near the end of the paper saying a possible solution that maybe wouldn't require sacrificing either of these kind of extremes is some sort of technology-based contact tracing, if you could address the privacy issues. So given my interest in medicine and my background in technology, I thought this would be a problem to tackle.
Now, you claim that this TrackCOVID smartphone app enables people to trace whether they've potentially contacted somebody who has the COVID-19, but in a way that ensures their privacy. Explain how that is possible.
So the way I think about it is we're not actually tracing the people. We're tracing the virus and the ways that the virus could move around. So more specifically, there's a few different contact tracing, you know, technology solutions out there. And basically what they all have to have in common is you have to somehow keep track of the points where transmission could occur. So like if I go out to the grocery store or if I go hang out with my friend at the park or whatever, you know, anytime I'm potentially exposing them or they're potentially exposing me, you have to somehow keep track of that. So my design and our team's design allows those points to be tracked. So every time, you know, you interact with somebody, I call them checkpoints. And so you create those checkpoints and people can keep track of which checkpoints they've been to without actually having to, so that information is stored on their device. And these are just kind of anonymous checkpoints, but the sort of like the server, the central computer, it's not keeping up with the people that have been here. Your device is keeping up with where it's been and who it's interacted with. And there's also, so there's no collection of any information other than some sort of abstract meeting happened. That's really all the information that's there. And so you can actually perform contact tracing that way without having to know the geographic locations where you've been or any personal details about who you are.
Ron, I've heard you say before that this type of an application is really important in being able to flatten the curve. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Absolutely. So one of the things that we're hoping is now that we've kind of plateaued here in the US and hopefully we start seeing cases start to decrease as we reopen the economy and people go back out in their daily lives, we want to avoid a second and a third wave. And so one of the kind of ways that we could do that is not only by increasing antibody testing and diagnostic testing, increasing hospital surge capacity, but also having an app that we can actually use to contact trace, like Tyler said, prevent the virus from spreading, and then allow people that may have come into contact with individuals that might be carrying the virus, allow them to find out that they might have been exposed. So the idea is that if we can get as many people as possible to use this app, be part of this ecosystem, we can actually dramatically decrease the curve. And this is kind of the flattening the curve idea that we had talked about earlier. But so these are some simulations that we ran, and you can see that the more people that actually use this app, the flatter the curve gets. So some of the numbers is if we just get 25% of people to start using the app, we can actually decrease infections by 25%, over 25%. And if we can get 50% of the population to use the app, then we can actually cut the curve in half. And the more people that use it, we can dramatically decrease the curve. And so that's really the idea, is that the more people that use it, the better.
And Tyler, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, if I could just add one thing. So, you know, these models that we ran, they're very kind of proof of concept to just kind of demonstrate that the idea could work. The actual numbers aren't you can't read from that how it would look like it's in, say, the United States. But there was a paper that came out in Science recently. The lead author was Ferretti. And they did, you know, more advanced mathematical modeling, and they actually used real data that we have about COVID-19. And they reached a similar conclusion that digital contact tracing could be effective if you can get enough people using the app.
Yeah, as Tyler mentioned, these are models. So we're not actually using any data that we've gathered, but this is kind of what we predict would happen if people actually used them.
One of the things we mentioned in our announcement about this new app is that it would probably be a good idea to share information about its availability in places like supermarkets and, you know, this sort of essential gathering places that people must go to maintain their daily lives. So is that a good example of a place where people should be able to pick up the app?
It's actually right now exists as a web app. So you don't even, I did build like a native app, but I like the web app better because you don't have to download anything. So the way I kind of envision this, you know, is that you would have public QR codes displayed at entrances to say grocery stores or whatever. And you can actually just pull out your smartphone, open your camera and just scan it. And you know, like these days, a little Chrome or Safari link will pop up. You just tap it and this will open right up to a web page that says you checked in, and that's all there's to it. You don't have to have ever used it before. You don't have to ever use it again until next time you go shopping or whatever. So even if you're not committed to the idea, if you're just willing to take 5 seconds to do that, that the full functionality is actually just built into that right there.
Ron, what do you have to add about the importance of, you know, this tracing software and other systems that are hopefully going to be available to help us track the spread of this infection?
Absolutely. So this is critical. This is part of the three-part strategy of really opening up the economy and getting life back to normal. We need to be able to find out who might be infecting others and try to mitigate that as much as possible. One of the big issues is with privacy. So there are other apps that are coming online that use Bluetooth and GPS to kind of track your location. But that's kind of a relatively difficult to get someone to download an app on their phone that effectively says that, hey, we're going to kind of see exactly who you come into contact with. And the nice thing is it kind of does everything automatically, but you have some privacy concerns there. So with this app, we're avoiding that as much as possible, making everything completely anonymized, and then just having this QR code that you scan at each checkpoint. And then we can kind of figure out who might have exposed, alert them, and try to mitigate disease spread as much as possible.
Tyler, where do people go to get this app?
You can try out the demo, poke holes in it, give me ideas for feedback or for improvement. It's trackcovid.net/app. Well, that's the URL for the app itself. If you want more information, just trackcovid.net.
Well, I want to thank you both for joining me today and sharing information about this new app. We were speaking with Tyler Yasaka from the UCI School of Medicine and Dr. Ron Sahyouni, who is now at UC San Diego. Thank you both very much for your time.
Thanks, Ryan.
And that's our first episode of the UCI podcast video series. I hope you learned a lot today, and you'll join us again in the future. Once again, I'm Brian Bell from the University of California, Irvine's Office of Strategic Communications. Thank you for watching. Thank you.